Hi everyone, Dr. Gonzo here. I know that we've been gone for a while and had a rather significantly long break, and you're kind of wanting, you probably expect us to come back and be all, ooh, cheeky monkeys and all funny and entertaining. And we will get to that eventually. There will be laughter and happiness in this episode. But first we kind of want to address something that happened and was a great tragedy to our community. Last week, January 23rd, Justin Carmichael, better known as JewWario, took his own life. It's hit everyone in the community very hard, and we're all kind of reeling from the loss and trying to understand why something like this would happen. And we're going to carry on. We're going to try and find the laughter because you know we think that's what Justin would want, but. I think it's important first to say goodbye and to pay our respects where we can, especially since most of us probably aren't going to be able to make it to Justin's funeral, much as we may want to be there. So sort of as a goodbye to Justin, I've gathered together some of his friends and colleagues to say a few words, and so yeah, Justin, to everyone who knew him, he was one of the dearest friends and the most beloved of brothers. He always had a kind word for anyone who needed it, or an encouraging slap on the back, and he's gonna be missed.
Hey. This kind of, can you hear me okay?
Yeah.
Okay. This completely hit me as a shock, and because I didn't realize Justin was dealing with depression at the time. Depression is a really, really, it takes you to some dark places. I know firsthand exactly how it feels. So I can only extend my love and offer some condolences to Justin's wife and his family. Because I know what it's like to be on the other side. He was such a nice guy. He laughed. He was full of love to give. He just wanted to make people happy.
Hey, this is Chris Rolotti, and Justin was easily the nicest person I ever knew. And that's a phrase that can be applied to a lot of people, especially when referring to them in passing. But without a doubt, that phrase is the ultimate way for me to describe Justin, because he was absolutely just the most kind-hearted person that I've ever known and that I may ever know. He had the ability that when he saw you, his face just lit up with this absolute genuine joy. You know, he's had this big beaming smile whenever he got to see somebody, whenever he got to talk to somebody. He just always lit up in such an amazing way. I was always very envious of his ability to just always think in such a positive way. He never had a negative attitude towards another person. He was always in such a happy place, and it's incredible. You know, he had that kind of smile that's just so earnest and so incredible. And It's horrible that he's no longer with us. It's tough to kind of really realize that he's not going to be there anymore. And it's tough to kind of accept that, because, you know, seeing that big face standing there in that kilt and his big pink shoes, you know, it's tough to accept that that's not there anymore. Justin was very much our Mr. Rogers, just so pleasant to be around, always just such a spirit to him that I earnestly feel that our world is a lesser place without him. But, you know, to take anything from this is that we should all, in whatever way we can, strive to be more like him, because he was an absolutely incredible person, and I'm glad that I got to know him, even if it was for as short of a time as it was.
Hey there. Yeah. This is Tom White. He's an evil genius. And I don't feel ready. I was told that we'd be doing a tribute here for Justin, but I'm still figuring out what it is I feel. How can I talk about what I feel if I haven't worked it out yet? I don't know. The first time we spoke was in 2009. I was posting my reviews in the Tigwitig forum, and he was one of the first people to respond, giving me genuine, positive, constructive criticism. At the time, I didn't even know who he was. All I knew was that he was a Tigwitig contributor, and that he had reached out to me on the forum. I checked his stuff out later, and it seemed okay. When I sent my stuff into Rob, I mentioned, hey, JewWario likes my videos, check it out, because, I don't know, can't hurt to mention that, right? And Rob seemed seriously impressed. I was kind of in over my head. It wasn't much later when I realized just how amazingly talented Justin was. I still believe that I never would have been picked up by Channel Awesome if not for him. I really believe that. I met him in person for the first time at MAGFest in January 2012. I told him just how much his feedback meant to me, and he seemed really touched. Right away, I could see he was just a really sweet guy. I found out he was coming to Kanji about a month and a half later, so I asked if he wanted to do a video together. He said sure, but then he had a tech issue and lost all the material he prepared for his panel. The guy stayed up all night long, redoing everything from scratch. Naturally, he wasn't able to do the video with me anymore, but it was understandable. I remember being there with him in the wee hours of the morning as he was printing his stuff out, and telling him about the time a codec problem had me up all night and into the afternoon, trying to fix my Monster Party review so I could get it uploaded in time for Halloween. And we just had this brief moment where we were just real. It was kind of a bonding experience. We didn't end up recording the video until 11 months later at the next MAGFest. But when we did, I was just blown away at how amazingly funny he was. Each and every take had me laughing. Just an incredibly talented, funny guy. He was there beside me when I found out that the wallet I lost back in Canada was turned in, and all the money was still inside. Funny thing is, the camera was rolling when I got that call. I actually just went back and watched it to see that moment that he and I shared. All in all, after getting all the voiceover lines done and all the editing, that video ended up taking us a year and a half to finish. But it's some of my proudest work. I'm just so grateful I was able to complete it while he was still with us. This past MAGFest, we didn't spend much time together, but we did have a moment. He asked me about how I was doing. I had gone through a really rough patch in the past 6 months. I told him I was good. I said it's better to have ups and downs than for everything to just be flat. I just keep coming back to that conversation. He didn't so much tell me, but I could tell something was wrong. I know, of course, there's no way I could have known, and I know there's nothing I could have done. But I just can't help but keep going back there. I do think it was the last time we spoke. We didn't talk about video games or videos we're working on or any of the other stuff people talk about at conventions. It was just the two of us being there for each other, just being a friend to each other. Justin was easily one of the sweetest, most cheerful people I've ever met. He's someone I could just never, ever be angry with. Everything that happened this past weekend felt real at the time, but I look back on it, and it all feels like a dream. Since I heard about his passing, I've just been hearing his laugh in my head all the time. I hope he's waiting for me on the other side. Heaven would be a sad place without Justin.
Justin was the first person on Tickwatik to really... Justin was one of my favorite people. He was warm, he was kind, he was encouraging, he was always happy to work with someone who was just an idiot who had much less of a fan base than him. He was so enthusiastic, he'd agree to anything I thought was funny, and he threw himself into it, and this is... I'm sorry.
Justin was always so very nice to me, and so very accepting and just fun to be around, and I used to listen to his streams sometimes when I worked from home, and I always said that with his voice he should go into motivational speaking, because he had a very calm and very relaxing tone of voice, and just a very happy and comforting demeanor, and he was always a good friend, and he was always there to talk, and I'm going to miss him a lot.
Justin got us both through some really, really hard things. Our podcast likely wouldn't exist if it wasn't for Justin. Our cooking show definitely wouldn't exist if it wasn't for Justin. The times working with him, 2013 and 2012 MAGFest, were some of the most fun times that I'd had making videos. I'm really sorry we didn't get one last chance to work with him at this MAGFest, just to say goodbye.
Hey guys, it's Chris, Steve Fowler. You guys may not know this, but I was an admin on the Justin JewWario stream, and I was there live when he talked about that. Remember that video where he just talked about, you know, you're not stupid, and that video has been like all around the internet 10,000 times over? Well, I was there live, and the story behind that. After he said that, I shot him on Skype, and I said, hey, Justin, you know, that really struck a chord with me, because it did. I mean, Justin helped me out with my comic, and he helped me out with my videos, and he would talk to me whenever someone would say, you know, Seafarer, your videos are stupid, blah, 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 no one can understand the thing you're saying, blah, 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 and he would tell me, you know, you're not, and... You're not stupid. I just happen to have a disability, and he understood that, and he helped me, and he said, you know, just be yourself. Who cares what other people think? And you know what? That's the kind of person JewWario Justin was. He was one of those nicest guys on the planet who would give you the shirt off his back, because he is that kind. He is that generous. And, you know, it's a shame what happened, because I personally never had to deal with depression, luckily, thankfully. But I've known people who have had to deal with that problem. And they've all said that depression it's a disease. It needs, you know, more care out there. More people know about the problems that people have that have it. And they need to talk it out with anybody. anyone who would listen, because there's always someone out there who's willing to listen. And Justin, he knew that too, but sadly, things just took a turn for the worst. And I think what I'm going to take away from all this is that I'm going to do things in his memory because he would want me and everybody else to just be positive, do what we do, you know, go out there and do amazing things like that video said, and just, you know, do the most awesome thing you can do possible. I mean, that's the best way you can honor a friend's memory who sadly passed away. And sadly, this is not the first time this has happened, and I won't get into details of that, but I can tell you that one thing's for sure, I am going to do what I can to honor Justin's memory, because he was not just a friend to me. He was a mentor. And he helped me to get through, you know, getting past my disability and everything. And that's what I'm always going to remember about Justin JewWario Carmichael. All right, that's the end of that. Lotus Prince?
All right, then. I'm trying to think about a start. I guess I'll say I'll open up with the simple stuff. You know, I started off like a lot of people did, just watching his videos on thatguywiththeglasses.com, and then when I became aware of his website, you can play this, you know, with the videos he made of the same name, I checked those out too, just to see what kind of producer he was. You know, there's a bunch of people on That Guy with the Glasses, so whatever, let's see how this goes. And of course his stuff was, you know, very entertaining, but what really got me about him was that he was extremely friendly and positive all the time. And keep in mind, this is when a lot of video game nerd sort of copycats came out, so like angry reviews are the cool thing to do. So it was very refreshing to see someone who's just, you know, very, very positive. All again, I'm being repetitive here, but very, very positive all the time in his videos, and very educational at the same time. He made me aware, like, you know, I was surprised to learn this, but he's a fellow JoJo's Bizarre Adventure fan. If it weren't for him, I don't think I would have been aware of the Part 5 game for the PS2. It's stuff like that. Like, it sounds like a stupid thing, like, oh, he had me find a game, but it's just one of those things where, like, I sort of made a connection. It's rather interesting because, you know, we're both Jewish, both named Justin, we're both JoJo fans. It's like, figure that out. I can't say that I really knew him personally. I live literally across the country from him. But when I first met him at MAGFest 9 in 2011, I immediately discovered that, you know how some people have their, you know, their public personality and then their private personality? Like, here's how the person is on the videos, here's how the person is in real life. Maybe you'll see a difference. He is exactly the same in real life as he is on his videos. Just an overwhelmingly friendly guy. And, you know, I may be a public speaker by profession, in a sense, but when it comes to private speaking, I'm rather introverted. So while I can engage in conversation, I have a very difficult time starting one, if that makes sense. But not the case with him. Again, extremely friendly and got me to relax in no time at all. So it got to the point where, you know, it was just a really good time. Anytime we would talk about anything. Last time I saw him was only a little while ago at MAGFest 12, 2014, just a few weeks ago. He was doing his pub trivia night. And I was regrettably unable to attend the one from the previous year, but this time I saw what all the hype was about. He has a really good, not that this was actually the radio, but he really has a voice for radio. This isn't the kind of thing you hear in his videos normally. I'm sure someone recorded this. If so, look it up, the pub trivia thing. But he really has that kind of you know, everyone get in on this, you're going to have a good time kind of voice. See, with his videos on You Can Play This, it's more kind of intimate, like you and me, let's talk about this. But this was a really good, you know, get everyone excited about the moment kind of thing, and it worked. And, you know, despite the fact that everyone in the room was sitting with strangers getting in a group, nobody minded, and it was just all sorts of good time for everyone. You know, I managed to talk to him later, told him about that. You know, he had a good time with that. He saw my friend who had gotten in on a couple of his Monster Hunter 3 streams on, you know, the group meetings whenever that would happen. So, you know, influencing all sorts of people in different ways, I guess. While I was unable to attend the last few streams he did because I was working at those times on the Fridays, I'll still remember this. This part's plainly easy to remember because he would do it every single time. You know, I saw the You're Not Stupid video that, as has been said, I'm sure, has been a buzz all over Facebook, internet, YouTube, everything. I wasn't there to see that one live, but the streams I did see, they're always just casual conversations with whomever in the chat or anyone he had talking on the mic at the time. But as I said before, he would always do the same exact thing at the end of every single stream. And he would always sing everybody out with the Mr. Rogers It's a Good Feeling song. And it sounds so corny because I haven't watched that show, you know, since I was a little kid, because that's the target age group to watch that show. But even so, it has just as much of an effect now as it always did. It kind of made you feel like, you know, yeah, you're right, man. Like, I'll catch you next time. And whether we actually did or not, it always gave that sort of warm feeling inside. That's pretty much what I got. It was an amazing sign out, and it was legitimately effective every single time in exactly the way that it was meant to be. While I, again, did not really know him personally due to having met him four times in my life, I can still say that he was a very positive guy, and he will always be remembered that way.
Well, a lot of what's been said, I wholeheartedly agree with. So I'll share with you some of my thoughts. I've met Justin a few times, mostly at conventions, and Justin was one of the few people that really welcomed me into the Tinkotig community when I first became a producer on the site back in 2010. First met him at MAGFest 2011. And it was us hanging out in his hotel room with Sean Faust watching this ridiculous video called Brokenware. And we all just sat there and just laughed and laughed. And Justin would tell me about import games. And I'm not sure how it went to this, but somehow I remember spanking his ass a lot that night. And him just begging to be let up. But he never lost that infectious smile that he had. And whenever he would see me, it would either be him or Lewis Linkara from across the hotel floor or whatever going, "Birdman!" And he always made me feel welcome. So when I ran into Justin again at Con G up in Guelph, Ontario, about a year later, having him sit down with him and Kaylin Marsgirl, it was such a fun time because I really got a chance to really kind of get to know him as a person. And he honestly was the best of us, at least one of the best examples of an internet personality and a man that I've ever met, simply because he was what I think some of us could aspire to. He was gracious to his fans, a fantastic and dedicated coworker, and he was enthusiastic for his craft. And the best part of all, he was humble about it. It never ruined him. It made him better because he was spreading his love to everybody around us. And we were more for having him in our lives, but we are less for having lost him. However, looking upon that, I realize that if we could be half as good to each other as Justin was to us, then a little piece of him lives on every day. And that's what I'm taking away from his life, not from his passing, because I'll speak about more of that in just a minute. But Justin really inspired me, and I didn't expect his passing to take me as hard as it did. For those of you that know me, I'm not the most emotional person in the world, and yesterday I couldn't stop crying. I actually had to be medicated so I could actually go to sleep for the first time in what feels like days. But Justin, he didn't suffer alone. I, like Mickey and others, know what he goes through. I'm a diagnosed bipolar depressive. I've been there. I've been in that dark space Justin was in. And I know how hard it can seem to be get out, and like your options are so limited, but they're not. We have such an incredible support system, both in US and Canada, for mental health. And I encourage you to reach out to them professionally or even among your friends. But knowing that there is options, there are people that know about you, that love you, and there are people that care about you, medical professionals or otherwise. So if you walk away from anything from this, learn from Justin's legacy and his life, be gracious, be humble, and be the love that Justin was. And if you take away anything from his death, know that the permanent solution to a short-term problem is not the answer, but reaching out is. Talking to those who see you every day, reaching out to the person you maybe haven't talked to in a long time. But communication is what will save lives. And communication ultimately is what keeps us together, because Justin's death brought us all together as a family. From Tig-Wa-Tig, from Reviewtopia, from strangers across the internet who we've never seen before. And we were united in our sorrow, but in the joy that we celebrated his life. So that's what Justin Carmichael meant to me.
At this time, I feel that it is appropriate to share with all of you some of the kind words that Justin had for anyone who needed them. Let them be a comfort to those who need them most.
You know what? I want you all to look at me. I want you all to look at me. I want you to, because what I'm about to say is important, I think. I've been thinking about this a lot lately. And I want you all to know this. This goes out to everybody. You're not stupid. Okay? You're not stupid. Don't ever tell yourself that you are. You're important. What you have in your head may not mean a lot to a lot of people, but it's what makes you special. You are important. You mean something. And you're going to go out there and you're going to do some wonderful things. But first and foremost, you're not stupid. You're not an idiot. Don't ever tell yourself that you are. And if nobody else ever tells you this, I will tell you this. I care about you.
Justin, you were loved, you are loved, and you will be missed. May whatever demons assailed you in this world be driven from you in the next, that you might find peace everlasting. And now, a moment of silence for Justin and all of the others who cannot be with us here on this night. Thank you. We're going to take a quick musical break and do Ask a Geek when we come back. All right, and we are back. And it's our belief here at Nerd of the Third Power that Justin wouldn't want us to dwell too much on his passing, that he would want us to find the laughter again. So that's what we're going to do. We're gonna find our laughter and try and do what we always do, which is to entertain you and put a smile on your face. So to that end, we're going to launch right into our Ask a Geek. So starting with a question from Charlie for Brian. If you could bring back any 90s comic book cartoon series, which would it be?
It would probably have to be the 90s Spider-Man cartoon I would have to bring back. And like I said, I know you're going to get on my case about it, at least for the theme song, and you're wrong. But that is the one show I really like to see come back, at least with newer episodes. I thought it was actually really good put together. And despite all like the censorship, they still were able to put on like a really good show. So I think this shows the strength behind it.
Well, it ended on a really big cliffhanger, didn't it?
It ended on a humongous cliffhanger that was never resolved because Mary Jane Watson, she disappeared, then she came back, but she was water, and we never really saw how that ended. Then he met Stan Lee, and they're like, all right, we're out. We're like,
Wait, back up just 1 second here, back up. She was water?
Yeah.
It was the 90s, it was a very weird time.
Well, he met Stan Lee?
Yeah, he met Stan Lee.
I'm confused.
So were we.
Well, at least he didn't sell her to the devil this time around.
But what sucked is because after that one closed, you had Spider-Man Unlimited show up, which was a continuation, but not a continuation. So we were even more confused. And just unfortunately, at that point, the Spider-Man cartoons have hit that peak again until about Spectacular Spider-Man. And unfortunately, that one also got canceled and been replaced with Ultimate Spider-Man, which has its own ups and down problems. So I wouldn't mind seeing a continuation of the old 90s Spider-Man with a better theme song.
Ultimate Spider-Man, that fell to the Cartoon Network curse, didn't it?
A little bit of Disney. The idea of, hey, we're going to make this show, but we're going to make it really silly and really very toy-oriented. And very sort of random humor, Family Guy-esque humor. But they didn't promote it as such, so we all sort of got blindsided by it when it got debuted. Because we're like, yeah, Spider-Man's back. Woo, Spider-Man? Why do you have a motorcycle? Like, that's kind of like what happened.
Okay. I mentioned this to Brian before we started recording the show, but I caught on YouTube a couple episodes of the old Incredible Hulk and She-Hulk cartoon. And wow, how did they get away with some of the shit they had She-Hulk wearing in that show? Because damn!
Because no one watched it. That is the answer. No one watched it.
And also, women's opinions aren't important.
I mean, yeah, it's just such.
Wait, everybody ignore Kat's opinion. No, I'm kidding. Yeah. Kidding.
I remember watching a couple episodes going, what is this? And then, like, I remember when She-Hulk showed up, I'm like, this is strange.
This makes me feel things.
Yeah. My pants are going all funny. But yeah, Kat, aren't you actually preparing a She-Hulk cosplay?
Yeah, my friends want to do a female Avengers group, and they were like, we've got you down for Loki. And I'm like, I know what female Loki wears. I don't have that much money to make that costume. I'm going to be She-Hulk.
Well, maybe you should watch a few episodes of this cartoon and get some outfit ideas.
No!
I was going to say, you would get better ideas from the comic itself, because at least there she wears a suit. An actual suit, because she's a lawyer.
She wears, like, clothing and stuff. I approve of wearing clothing.
Okay, next question. Actually, this is one that was something that we were just talking about earlier. This is from Ray, and he wants to know what we all think of the announced Sly Cooper movie. Well, since I'm the Game Crush one, I'll go first. I actually...
Really? After a squeal like that, and you're like, well, me.
Okay, fine, John, proceed.
Well, now I'm all self-conscious.
Should have thought about that before you squealed.
I can't help it. I have an unhealthy love for the Sly Cooper games. They're some of my favorite, like, platformy style game things ever, and I've been saying for years that it should be like a TV series or a movie, like just some sort of cartoon, and I'm thrilled to death that this is actually happening. And as far as I can tell from the teaser trailer, they're even going with the game's voice cast, which makes me entirely too enthusiastic, because I would have been absolutely furious if they had recast Bentley. If nothing else, I would have been furious if they'd recast Bentley. I'll say that they've done some tweaking to the character designs, because they're going for a 3D look instead of like that kind of, you know, quasi-3D, quasi-cell-shaded thing they were going for. And it looks a little weird. I'm not entirely used to it yet, but I think it could work. I'm gonna, you know, suspend judgment on that, but yeah, I'm excited. I am excited.
Okay, alright. I actually just heard about these this morning, so I don't really know. John knows more of the details than I do, but it's definitely a different approach from what the usual approach is for video game movies, which is to give it to Uwe Boll and tell it to bite the pillow dry. Excuse me, bite the pillow. But well, yeah, I don't know. The idea. I'm kind of surprised at the idea of taking a video game character and making what I'm guessing is ostensibly going to be a kids movie out of it. I'm surprised that never occurred to Hollywood before. Unless the last attempt to do that was the Super Mario Brothers movie, in which case, yeah, probably a good idea to sit and wait on this for a while.
It's really weird. It's like they've always been trying to force video game movies into live-action movies, and I've never figured that out, because there are so many, you know, colorful and cartoony video games out there, like, you know, the Mario series, which should have been animated in the first place, if they had attempted to make a movie out of it.
Well, they did attempt to animate the Mario Brothers, and we got the Super Mario Brothers Super Show, so maybe kind of leave that one alone a bit.
Hey, no one talks bad about Captain Lou Albano as Mario, so fuck you.
Fist bump, Ryan. Fist bump. Yeah, I actually still have a soft spot for the Super Show.
Wasn't there a Sonic TV show?
There's like four of them.
There were
three of them, and I can go on at length about the Sonic TV shows, and there is another one. Okay, three in America, one in Japan, and there is another one in the works being animated in France, which is going to be airing on Cartoon Network sometime eventually.
Yeah, there was Sonic the Hedgehog, with the ABC version, or Sonic Sat AM, as they call it, which is the good one.
That's the best.
That's also one that Archie Comics are based off of. There was Adventures of Sonic the Hedgehog, which was the neo-cubist Pablo Picasso one that aired on like Fox Kids at 6 in the morning. And then
it started on weekday afternoons.
Did it?
Yeah, I was always angry when I was a kid, because I would never get home in time from school except to see the ending credits. I'd be like, damn it.
But Picasso.
Yeah. Then there was Then there was Sonic Underground, which premiered a few years later, and a lot of people liked to say it was really good. I thought it was kind of terrible, because there was a musical number every single fucking episode. But you know,
I thought it was terrible because it's a tease. It was like, yeah, we're gonna be like the Sat-Am, but not like anything that you liked about the Sat-Am.
Yeah, and then there was Sonic X, which was the anime, which the less spoken about that, the better.
Oh, and there was also a two-episode anime OVA that was ages and ages ago, and that thing is so freaking weird.
Most anime from the 90s is weird.
Yeah. I love 90s anime. Do not talk about 90s anime.
I'm not saying it was weird bad. I'm just saying it was weird. It had Metal Sonic in it, though, so, you know, that was pretty cool.
Okay. So, all right, anybody else have any thoughts about the Sly Cooper movie?
I have nothing.
Guessing not.
Okay, there's going to be a Sly Cooper movie.
Hey, that's a thing!
That's a thing now.
Jump and press the circle button!
You know, it makes me wonder if there's going to be a tie-in video game to the movie.
Oh, man, that would be so weird. It would be like Street Fighter the movie, the game.
Okay.
Which was a real thing. But
yeah. My brother owned it.
That sounds
meta. It just might happen.
I actually have a copy of Street Fighter the Movie, the game, for my Sega Saturn, and it's exactly what you expect.
Yes,
it's not a game I would recommend playing sober. It's a great drinking game, but not something you play through sober.
Drink every time there's Jean-Claude Van Damme.
because you
need to be drunk for Jean-Claude Van Damme.
And chug the whole can whenever someone actually manages to pull off a special move. Anyway, next question comes from Mark, and it's for me, and he wants to know what my thoughts are on the rumors of Nintendo working on their next-gen video game system. See, the thing is, with the Wii U doing so lackluster in sales, I can almost believe that this is true. If it is, I'm going to withhold judgment until I see some system specs. That said, it seems really early in the game for them to be working on a brand new system. Probably what's happening is if it is true, what's probably happening is they're probably just working out like the bare minimum of specs at this point. Like, they're basically just settling down on a name and a concept. I don't think there's any real hardware specs yet. But, you know, hey, I'm keeping an eye on it, so more on that as it develops. And he also wants to know what I think of the Oya. I actually managed to get my hands on one a couple weeks ago. It's a neat little machine, but there's definitely some flaws in its execution. There needed to be some it needed to be run through quality assurance a few more times before it went to market. So, you know, it's a curiosity. That's really all it is. Okay. Next question here is from Nate, and it is for John, and by extension, all of us. Who are our favorites to win at the Oscars this year?
Oh, this question. I'm always caught unprepared for this question, because I don't pay as much attention to the Oscars as I probably should.
Anyway.
Also, I'm really, really bad most of the time at predicting, unless it's like super obvious. Like, I knew Scorsese was going to win a couple years ago just because, you know, he was overdue. But I'm so bad at predicting. I'm trying to think of what the Oscar runners, what the nominees are for Best Picture this year. Come back to me.
Hold on, I have the list pulled up of what's nominated for Best Picture.
Oh, please to share.
Please to share. Best Picture nominees is American Hustle, Captain Phillips, Dallas Buyers Club. What is Dallas Buyers Club?
Oh, that's the one with Woody Harrelson's on drugs. That's most of his movies, but that's another one.
Oh, I was like, wait, which one? let's see. Gravity, Her, Nebraska, Philomena, 12 Years a Slave, and Wolf of Wall Street.
Okay, yeah, several of those aren't a surprise. I'm going to put my money on Gravity.
That's okay.
I bet I can guess what Kat's favorites for the Oscars are. Frozen for everything.
Frozen for every. I think they only got like three nominees, but...
Even for Best Documentary.
Yes.
Frozen wins for Best Supporting Actor.
Best foreign language film. Frozen in Korean.
I will say this. If Frozen loses... If they pull another Wreck-It Ralph and Frozen loses to Cars 2... Not Cars 2. What was the one that came out? Planes. If Frozen loses out to Planes, there's going to be rioting in the fucking streets.
If Frozen loses out to Planes, I'm going to have to start questioning my whole religious belief system.
It'll be pretty much if Frozen loses to... I don't know. There's a couple of shows that it's up against. It's actually not up against Planes. It's against The Croods, which won't win. Despicable Me 2, which was really excellent, but won't win. And then Ernest and Celestine and Miyazaki's film, The Wind Rises, which I think is the real competition there. Ooh. But it's a Miyazaki film, so it won't win. So Frozen wins by default.
Didn't Spirited Away win?
Yes, but no other Ghibli film has ever won.
Yeah,
and Spirited Away is Spirited Away. Come on, that's yeah, kind of not fair.
I don't think Spirited Away was a Miyazaki film. Like, I know it was a Ghibli film, but I don't think it was Miyazaki.
I think it was Miyazaki. Yeah, I'm pretty sure that one was Miyazaki.
All right, well, someone signed off in the comments and settled the debate for us.
Let's just we'll ask him the next time he retires.
And then comes back and then retires after his next movie and then comes back and retires after his next movie.
I would want to see Gravity win because that I haven't seen it, but it sounded like a very interesting concept and something kind of new and original. in this industry of rehashes and remakes, but I'm thinking that it's probably going to go to her, because Joaquin Phoenix is a darling of the critics, and I think he's actually kind of due for an Oscar.
He could always win the best actor, though.
Fair. I'm actually expecting American Hustle to clean up. I was watching the Golden Globes the other night, and there was just they could not throw enough statues at that movie.
The movie's just over there going, ow, stop!
Hit him again!
Yeah, pretty much. Pretty much. I mean, I would love to see Gravity or Her take Best Picture, because those are both really, really nifty, imaginative films, but, you know, I'm not too optimistic about their odds versus American Hustle.
Watch Wolf of Wall Street clean and just surprise all of us.
Well, that's it's earned a few awards too. I mean, all I'm really interested in is if Pacific Rim got nominated for anything and what categories. I mean, obviously it's going to be it's going to be effects of some sort.
I'm going to break it to you. I don't think they got any nominations at all.
They didn't. Oh man, no. Now I got.
They didn't get.
It wasn't depressing enough.
I know. It's get me started.
See, I was actually hearing about this a little while ago, where people were absolutely flipping their shit because it didn't get a visual effects nomination, and The Lone Ranger did.
What?
Yeah. What?
Not only that. There's another one. Is that I know a lot of people who don't like Man of Steel, but for fuck's sake, Man of Steel should at least gotten a nod for visualization too. Like Pacific Rim and Man of Steel should have been both in there. Story to the side, visually it was good.
I'm just trying to figure out what visual effects there were in The Lone fucking Ranger.
There was a train scene.
Johnny Depp's makeup.
There's a whole category for makeup.
Oh, I'm sorry. Johnny Depp's bird on his head.
Goes to costume. That's a category.
God damn it. Just Johnny Depp. Just Johnny Depp himself. He wasn't
Johnny
actually.
Depp isn't actually
no,
in the
he
film,
wasn't there.
It's just the best animated figure ever.
And they got Tim Burton to do the animation. Because where Johnny Depp goes, Tim Burton is not too far behind.
It was stop motion. If that's how really good it was.
It's just the best. It's the best.
Okay. Brian, what about you? Who are your favorites for the Oscars?
I got no favorites because haven't seen any of those films. I'm terrible.
I haven't seen any of them either, actually, now that I'm looking at the list. Not a damn one.
I'm pretty far behind on movies myself because this has been one hell of a year for me.
Yeah.
But,
to me, like, I kind of stopped paying attention to the Oscars. I knew like last year's like Argo, everyone had a a huge hard on for that. I was like, oh, that's probably gonna win, and it did. So it's like, all right, Gravity might be win. Her is one everyone's talking about right now, so it might be her.
I do hear a lot of buzz about Wolf of Wall Street though, so that is another serious contender.
Yeah,
so I'm just still disappointed that it's not actually a werewolf movie.
I would watch it if it were about that.
Says, I'm a werewolf now, and we're going to buy these stocks.
Ooh, Werewolf Wall Street.
Flea collar criminal. Anyway.
Mr. Stevenson, is there a reason why every 28 days you suddenly pour all of your money into garlic shares?
Make this a thing. This needs to be a thing, guys.
This needs to be a thing. We'll try.
If movie titles were honest. Wolf of Wall Street.
Yep.
Okay.
Except garlic is vampires. It's silver for.
Well, he was making a joke about werewolves hating vampires, I think.
Oh, that.
Yeah, that was
okay.
What you were going for, right?
Yep. See, John gets it.
Yeah, see?
Yeah.
I'm on top of it.
Did you hear that wishing noise? That was the joke going straight over my head. Sorry about that.
Okay. Next question here is from Natalie, and it's for Kat. And it's actually another Oscar-related question. She wants to know, Kat, your thoughts on the years that the Academy split the animated award between Best Animated Feature and Best Hand-Drawn Animated Feature.
Wait, what? Wait, what? Best animated feature and best hand-drawn animated feature? That's a thing now?
I'm guessing this is news to you. They've done that for the last like couple of, I don't know if they're still doing it, but they did that for several years. They split
really?
Best they there was an award for best animated feature and then an award for best hand-drawn animated feature.
I had no idea. I thought there was like feature length animated feature and like animated short film. But I didn't know. I've never heard of anything about hand-drawn, and I'm looking on the Oscar website right now trying to find this, and I don't see anything about it.
Let's say, this sounds really news to me as well.
Yeah.
There's animated feature film, short film animated. That's all I'm seeing.
Well, you know what probably happened? That when we had that split, like before everyone went computer-generated, you still had a couple hand-drawn stuff, traditional stuff coming out. So maybe they split it. But then there's so few hand-drawn animation stuff now. They're like, well, fuck that, just one category. So we might have missed it.
It's entirely maybe. Possible. I'm just.
I blinked during that window.
Because yeah. I'm looking and I don't see anything about it. I'm gonna look this up. I'm gonna Google this.
Yeah, I'm gonna have to do some research on this myself because I'm the movie guy and I should know this.
I'm just going to go on the internet and watch Cats.
Yeah, I don't see anything about this. I don't know that this exists.
Maybe this is something they're considering doing and haven't done yet. Maybe that was the question.
I don't know. She wants to know what Cat's opinion on it is. I guess I don't know.
Well, Cat, in this hypothetical situation, what's your opinion on it?
I almost would say something like that. I don't want to say it would be pointless because of the sheer amount of computer-drawn stuff, but I feel like if you did that, you would still have to break it down between feature length and short animated film, and that would be really complicated. Like, the Oscars already can't handle having this many animation categories because they do everything they can not to give animation awards.
Seriously.
Sure of them. So, now there's ducks.
That was the penguin, thank you.
Was that a penguin?
That was the penguin. That's from the Adam West show, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Yes. Burgess Meredith was Oswald Chesterfield Cobblepot.
I'm so confused right now. but I think it would be neat, but I think there's just not enough of it. Because how the films get nominated, you have to actually have your film run in theaters in LA for a certain amount of time between certain dates. And not enough films, even short, you know, hand-drawn films, aren't going to be able to actually get nominated because of how difficult it is.
Yeah, so. Because LA is the center of the universe, and therefore everything has to come here.
Right? So I think it could probably be something good for a lot of, like, if it were possible, it would be good for, like, foreign films, because we just don't do it enough in the U.S. anymore. But I think there's probably some good stuff out of Europe that would probably potentially get nominated if it could fulfill those requirements.
Yeah, I think since you brought up the point that the U.S. pretty much doesn't really do hand-drawn animation very much anymore, but other countries still, you know, don't suck as much. I think it would almost be better to divide it between, you know, best foreign language animated film, or maybe even not foreign language, best, you know, foreign animated film versus, you know, best, you know, American animated film. I think that would make more sense to me.
That might be complicated. Well, I don't know. It's kind of hard to say, because a lot of films just, they get released all over the world. Like, certainly, like, every Disney film is going to get released all over the world, and a lot of, like, Miyazaki's films get released in a lot of different places, but we just don't see any of those foreign animated films. Not a lot of them make it over here.
Which is unfortunate, because some of them are amazing.
If they got their own category, that would be kind of neat. But I don't know that it would actually make anything better? I don't know.
Hi, DK.
Hi, DK. This is all hypothetical world.
Okay. All right. Next question here is from Elise, and it is for all of us. And she wants to know, this question is also several weeks old, so bear in mind the datedness of this. She wants to know what we're most excited about for My Little Pony Season 4. And I'm going to say right now, this week's episode, Weird Al Yankovic, I am so there.
Yep. I never thought I would live to see the day.
There's pretty much, like, nothing that could make me happier. Like, I've liked a lot of the stuff that's gone on with this season. Applejack gets to sing, and it's awesome. And Rarity, you know, has a really good... And everybody's gotten their really good episodes in. Can we just talk about Flutterbat for a second?
Oh, can we never stop talking about Flutterbat? Flutterbat is basically the apex of this series for me. It's all downhill from here.
But Weird Al, man, I don't even know if the fandom can handle it, because if there was going to be any particular singer or artist who I could envision fitting well into ponies and it going over miraculously well, Weird Al is it. It's Weird Al. Weird Al was born to be on this show eventually, hopefully, maybe.
Also, if I if the clip I saw is any indication, his cutie mark is a cheese sandwich and an accordion.
Yes, I definitely saw an accordion, and he was wearing like cheese for shoes. Like, what is going on here? This is awesome.
Okay. Brendan, Brian, what are you guys? What about you? What are you guys most excited for season four?
Actually, starting to watch it because I'm still behind and haven't started. I've been busy, and now not so much. So I probably have time to catch up.
Okay, Brendan, what about you?
I'm kind of in the same boat as he.
Ah.
So yes, I tell you what. I know. Shun me if you must.
I tell you what. This past episode with Discord.
Oh
my God.
God, I was gonna say if nobody else brought it up, I was gonna ask if we could just take a minute to talk about Discord having a song.
Oh my God, that was amazing.
Also, Gonzo, why have you not changed your default icon on Facebook to Discord dressed as Hunter S. Thompson yet?
Because I can't find a high quality version of it. All the ones I find are like real grainy. I need a high def cap of it. No, I saw that and I was like, yes, it's going on Facebook tonight. That was amazing.
I'll see what I can do for you.
I also caught the 300 reference where they're hauling Discord across Equestria, and his chariot is the same design as the one Xerxes had in 300.
Yeah,
I missed that. That went.
And then
the Risky Business and Flashdance references.
Yes.
My girlfriend,
really obscure.
Flashdance.
My girlfriend loved that. The Risky Business reference. She loved that.
Oh my God.
Yeah. No. This.
Discord makes everything better.
I was kind of a little disappointed that we didn't get some more characterization from Cadence. Because every time she's appeared, she's been a very satellite character. I'd really like to see an episode actually dedicated to her. Because I don't feel like she's got much character of her own. She's always just kind of there. But, I mean, that's just me.
Except for, you know, her wedding and stuff.
Yeah, but even then, that wasn't really... They didn't really take a lot of time to really develop her character.
Yeah, we got more characterization of Chrysalis than Cadence in that episode.
Yeah.
Which I'm totally okay with.
I'd love to see Chrysalis come back again.
Best villain is best villain.
She is my favorite villain, honestly.
I also will love the Power Ponies episode until the day I die.
Oh.
Flutter Hulk. Fluttershy's gone through some odd transformations this season. I'm kind of wondering what's coming next.
the part of the Power Ponies episode that actually made me laugh the hardest was actually when they're trapped in the cage and they finally get freed, and Rarity magics the staircase into being, and she just prances down it with her head held high like, bitch, I'm flawless.
Bitch, I'm Green Lantern.
But no, it really seems to me like My Little Pony has really stepped up its game this season.
I I think they're definitely doing a lot more this season. I think now, they're trying a lot of different things. They're playing around. They're having fun. That's what this season really feels like. Is just like the storytellers were like, "Fuck it, we're gonna do whatever we want."
Well, if you think about it, you know, when season 3 first started, they thought that was going to be the end of it because they're going to hit the 65 episode syndication mark. Now they've got season 4, and it's already confirmed they're doing a season 5. So now it's like, fuck it, we're going to have some fun now. This playground's ours, bitches.
It feels kind of like the Phineas and Ferb thing. It's like, yeah, this is a cool concept, and after a while, like, fuck, this we're just being silly. We don't really care about story.
I don't know. Phineas and Ferb still has a really, like, strangely strong continuity running throughout all of it. I mean, they're still making callbacks. They make callbacks to their callbacks.
Now, this isn't a question that showed up in the Ask Geek, but this is something I want to ask. What do you guys think of the recent announcement of Equestria Girls 2?
I vomited in my mouth a little.
I did have a deep sigh, and then I had to go take a bubble bath.
It does not affect me one way or the other. So, I'm content to let it exist as its thing. I will probably watch it. I will probably alternately laugh and cringe.
Yeah, that's probably what's going to happen. I can't say I'm excited about it, but I know I'm still going to watch it and probably acquire the soundtrack in some form or another and pray for more wonderful cameos like the great... Isn't Trixie supposed to be part of
it? Yeah, she's supposed to have a bigger role, as in, you know, an actual role. But yeah, it's
in her great and powerful hoodie.
It's yes, it's not for me. I know it's not for me, so I don't care.
I'm gonna say the same thing that I said about the first one. This is either going to it's either going to be totally awesome, or it is going to be a monument to all of our sins.
I like that the only two ways it can go.
I don't understand why it can't be both.
Yeah, it can't be both.
I don't know, like, I really like the first one, and I remember most of us liking it as well, although...
It was a surprise. That's what it was. It was like, oh, it's...
We were like, what? This is
not terrible.
Entertaining-ish.
But I feel like they're pushing themselves. It's kind of, it's like, what? Hey, we got away with one. Like, yeah, we got away with one. We're gonna do two. Okay, hold on. Away with one.
What I'm curious to see is if they're gonna try to do the whole Twilight transported to the human world thing again, or if they're just gonna stick in the human universe entirely. I'm not even 100% sure if human is the right word to use for that universe. They've got the Doug syndrome going on where everybody's like weird colors.
That's true.
It frightens something me a little water. Bit. I feel like you know, like in Doug, you were like, they all have gangrene. This is frightening. Somebody's got
Skeeter's past his expiration date.
yeah, colors. I don't know about that.
Why does Fluttershy have jaundice? Forget that. What happened to Rarity? She is clearly a ghost. Okay.
Man, I just realized she looks almost exactly like Spectra from Monster High. Whatsoever.
Okay. Okay. We'll see if I got any other really good questions in here.
I don't know, but we've been going for quite a while.
Okay. All right. Well, then we'll just end the Acid Geek there. Then. Okay. All right. Well, that's all the Acid Geek questions that we have for this week. As always, you can send them to us through the email at billysmith@channelawesome.com or drop them in the That Guy with the Glasses forum thread of the same name. Personally, I prefer if you send them to us through email. It's a little easier for us to keep track of it that way. So, we're going to take a quick music break. When we come back, we're going to be discussing recuts and remasters and re-releases. So stay tuned. We've got a lot of fun stuff ahead.
Okay, and we are back. And it's not exactly common practice, but it's something that's that is done a lot. And that's the recutting of films, either in like a director's cut where they add in new scenes or they reshoot old scenes. Or in some cases, like for example, the Richard Donner cut of Superman, where they just give us a mash of a half-finished film. So one of the things we kind of want to examine is sort of why this happens or why it's sometimes necessary in a few cases. So, you know, John, I think the first thing we should look at is how a studio tends to treat a film as it's in production. So, John, why don't you give us a little bit of the info on how that works?
Well, I can sum up how studios treat a lot of films while they're in production in one word. Shoddily. See, the problem is, there is this real tug of war that goes on in Hollywood with any particular movie between the executives and the creatives. And it's kind of an uneven tug of war because it's kind of like, you know, playing tug of war against the Hulk, because 9 times out of 10, the executives have all of the power. You very, very rarely get a filmmaker who is able to get any leverage in these arguments, and sometimes they get it through reputation alone. Like, I'm pretty sure anything James Cameron says goes at this point. The same thing happened with George Lucas, much to the world's detriment with the prequel trilogy. But every now and then you get a director like Guillermo del Toro, who I don't know how he does this, but he actually has a certain amount of power in his movies. Like when he was making Hellboy, the executives wanted Hellboy to basically be the Incredible Hulk. They wanted him to be a normal guy who just turned into Hellboy when, you know, he needed the superhero around. And Del Toro was like, how about no?
That's not retarded in any way, shape, or form.
Yeah, seriously.
I like Del Toro's response. They just, no.
But Del Toro did not always have this amount of pull and this amount of clout. I speak here of one of his earlier efforts, a movie called Mimic, which was about basically giant shape-shifting alien kill bug. And
that was the thing in a museum, wasn't it?
No, I...
Or am I thinking of The Relic?
I think you're thinking of The Relic. Thinking of The Relic. Mimic was like giant alien cockroach monster thing. Mimic recently got a director's cut released, which I have not yet seen, but given that it's Del Toro, I expect it to be, you know, 100 million times better than what made it to the theater, and Del Toro himself complimented what made it to the theater, but he had no choice. Because the problem with executives is that they are completely... Well, this is their strength and their weakness. They're completely concerned with the bottom line, which is okay to an extent because artists are kind of infamous for being wildly impractical and spending themselves into bankruptcy if they don't have somebody watching the money. So you need somebody watching the money, but the problem is executives think they know what's going to be successful, and they very often don't have any idea what they're talking about. They're kind of removed from reality. They're kind of in their own little world. And they don't actually know what makes for a successful movie, but they think they do. And unfortunately, they have all the power. So they make these odd, arbitrary decisions. Like, you know, oh, female lead action heroes don't sell. Or R-rated horror movies will never be successful, and then, you know, R-rated horror sci-fi movies will never be successful, and then you get things like The Hunger Games and Prometheus to prove them wrong, and or my personal favorite, I don't remember what the movie was, but there was someone who was trying to make a pirate movie like several years ago, and Hollywood was like, no, there's no money in pirate movies. And like a year or two after that, there was this little known thing from Disney that came along. You may have heard of it. And that's just the situation we're in right now. We have a situation where all of the power and money is in the hands of people who know how to manage money, and that's basically all they know, and they think they know how to be creative and how to make a good movie, and they really should just be sticking to the office stuff. So,
But there have been cases where the director has had significant amounts of power in the production of the film. Like Peter Jackson, he did The Lord of the Rings. They pretty much gave him free reign.
Yeah, and that's another instance. I'm not sure how directors like Peter Jackson and Guillermo del Toro pull it off. I don't know. Maybe there's something in their contracts, or maybe they... in del Toro's case, it could have been that it was him who had the rights to Hellboy and not the studio. Because I know that Mike Mignola still holds all rights to the character instead of Dark Horse, so maybe del Toro had some leverage because he owned the film rights. No idea what it is with Peter Jackson, because the Lord of the Rings film rights is a very complicated story.
Another thing is when The Lord of the Rings was first announced, Peter Jackson wasn't nearly as big a name as he is now.
No, it really wasn't. I mean, it was The Lord of the Rings that kind of made his reputation. Before that, he was probably best known for, you know, The Frighteners and Bad Taste, which were neither one of them what I would call a major blockbuster.
Didn't he also do Meet the Feebles?
Yes, he did do Meet the Feebles.
Ugh.
Peter Jackson did some weird-ass movies before he got hold of Tolkien. I don't know. Every now and then it happens. I'm also going to say every now and then it's good when a director has to exercise some restraint, when they have some restraints put on them. Again, I have to speak to George Lucas here, because a lot of the original ideas he had for Star Wars were very different from what wound up on the screen, primarily because of money and some people saying, no, George, that's probably not going to work, George. And Star Wars turned out pretty damn good, and then you had the prequels where he had no restraints and no limits to how much money he could throw at it, and you see what happens. So I don't know, it is kind of complicated, because sometimes the execs will be right.
I will add something to that. if anyone's actually curious on how Star Wars would have been originally, Dark Horse, before they're losing their license to Marvel, has released, I'm not sure if it's all done yet, a series called The Star Wars, which is a comic interpretation of the original screenplay that George Lucas had put together for Star Wars. And I'm going to tell you something right now, it is fucking weird.
I believe it, because wasn't Han Solo like some kind of weird alien thing?
And like Obi-Wan Kenobi was not who you thought he was, and then you had Star Killer, not Skywalker, and it's fucking weird. It is like, it's cool to kind of see, but you're kind of reading it going, you know what, I'm kind of glad this didn't make the screen.
Well, Luke's character was... Yeah, and wasn't Luke's character a girl at one point in the original writing?
I don't know if it was... Luke was originally a girl, or at one point became a girl, but then wasn't a girl.
So we're going a little Ozma of Oz here?
Yeah, a little bit. So I don't really know exactly, but I just want to say, if anyone's curious about what might have been, there you can check that series out.
I kind of want to find that now, thank you. I had no idea that existed.
Yeah, they promoted it, and they're like, all right, we're done.
Mic drop, boom.
Yeah, like, we're going to make this. Enjoy. Is it good? We're going to make this. Enjoy.
Who cares? We're out, bitches.
We're gone.
And scene.
Okay. Well, now we're... Some of these... Putting the train back on the track. So now we're starting to see, we didn't really see it so much with VHS, but now with DVD being the dominant medium and Blu-ray catching up, we're starting to see a bunch of recuts of older films being released. And I guess the question I have is this really necessary, or do these new cuts add or subtract largely from the films that they're based off of? I can tell you when the Richard Donner cut of Superman 2 was released, everyone was talking about it. And praising it like it was like a gift from God himself, come down on a silver chariot pulled by a choir singing angels. I still haven't seen it myself, so I don't know what the big deal is. But, like, what's the story behind that?
Well, I'll tell you what the big deal is. It is a completely different movie. Like, yeah, it is a completely different movie from the original Superman 2. Like, scenes are completely changed around, different context, different happenings, different special effects that weren't quite completed. But yeah, like, that was the whole big thing is because Richard Donner got fired, like, in the middle of production.
Yeah, it's strange. Richard Donner had a lot of conflict with the studio when he was making Superman, but he was really ahead of his time because he conceived of Superman and Superman 2 kind of simultaneously. And he went pretty much, as I recall, he went pretty much straight into the shooting of Superman 2 when he was done with Superman 1. Which, like I said, way ahead of its time. Nobody did that back then, but he knew that Superman was going to be a hit. But, like I said, the studio didn't really like him, and he didn't really like the studio, so he was in the middle of production on Superman 2 when they just completely canned him and replaced him. And I can't remember the name of the director they replaced him with off the top of my head, but from what I recall, this was like his first action or serious movie. He was mostly known for comedies. And so he made a couple of really weird choices in Superman 2. A lot of the weirder, more inexplicable stuff that people are always like, you know, well, what was with that cellophane Superman emblem that he threw off his chest and that memory-erasing kiss? A lot of that stuff came from the other director.
And in the new version, that stuff just that doesn't exist. We still don't have an answer for that fucking cellophane S. I mean, because it was, look, I have a cellophane S. And like, oh, I broke out of it. All right, next scene. I'm like, wait, what? Okay.
It's like it's like the Family Guy gag where he's like, yeah, didn't see that coming, did you? but it's... For full disclosure, I have not seen all of the Richard Donner cut yet. But what I saw was exactly like Brian said. It was a totally different movie. And from what I could tell, it was a better movie, a more coherent movie. And it kind of makes me wish that had been the version that we wound up with.
Yeah, so you get sort of like, it's an alternate, almost like an alternate history take. You know, like, this is the movie I wanted to make. Didn't get a chance to, but now, after years upon years... we were able to sort of cobble it together and give you an idea of what, you know, sort of happens. Weirdly enough, that's a rarity too. Like you have director's cut, but this was like a director's cut that was almost a brand new film in a sense.
Yeah, it's really true. Like with director's cuts, usually it's just stuff that they wanted to throw in that they had to cut for length or pacing or whatever. And again, that varies a little bit. Sometimes director's cuts are actually not as good as the original version because they wind up being too long or give them weird pacing issues. And you wind up watching them going, yeah, okay, I see why they cut that. Every now and then you get like this really odd sort of director's cut, like the director's cut of Alien, which came out on DVD a couple years ago, paired up with the original cut. What's weird about that one is that the director's cut is actually shorter than the theatrical cut.
Yeah, there's also a lot of weird shit in that cut that I can see why it was cut and it should have been cut. Like, there's one scene near the end of the movie where Ripley's running through the ship as it's about to explode, and she comes across, I can't remember his name, Dallas, I think?
The captain?
Yeah, and he's cocooned and he's being turned into an alien egg. And like, yeah, that's not how that shit works. So
yeah,
I can see why that was cut.
To kill him.
Yeah. But then they also did the same thing like with Aliens. There were a couple of scenes cut that I felt really sort of really established Ripley's character for that film. Like the scene that got cut where she finds about, you know, after she's been woken up after 57 years, she finds out that her daughter has already passed away. And I, you know, the first cut of Aliens that I saw was actually that director's cut. So when I watched the theatrical cut and that scene was in there, I was like, well, wait a minute, why'd they cut that out? That's a huge part of Ripley's character in this movie. That's why she's so protective of Neo.
Yeah, that's character building stuff, man. I shouldn't have left.
And then penguins.
And then penguins.
You know, we keep doing this. I keep expecting the fucking Hamburglar to just show up out of nowhere.
It's a rubble, rubble, rubble.
So,
I'll give you one example of another Ridley Scott movie that had a director's cut which really seriously improved on the theatrical version, and that's Legend. Am I the only one who's seen Legend?
I've seen Legend, but I don't think I've seen this cut that you're talking about.
Are you referring to I Am Legend, or
No, I'm talking about the 80s. I'm talking about the 80s fantasy movie with Tom Cruise and Tim Curry as like gigantic horned demon guy.
Oh yeah, I've never seen it, but I've seen pictures of Tim Curry Satan.
Yeah, Tim, those are the biggest horns that have ever
existed.
They were Tim Curry had to sign two contracts for that role, his and his chiropractors.
But it's really fascinating how different the two cuts are. There are a few things that make absolutely no freaking sense in the original movie that suddenly fit into a context in the cut. And the original movie shows Tim Curry's character, like, right off the bat. He's, like, pretty much the first character you see in the movie. Whereas the director's cut builds up to revealing what he looks like. And most interestingly of all to me is the original theatrical release had a score by this 80s... This 80s synthesizer group called Tangerine Dream, which is, you know, it's really good, and it's nostalgic if you like 80s stuff, but it didn't particularly age very well and didn't necessarily fit with the fantasy theme. But the score that the studio excised at the last minute to replace with the Tangerine Dream score was a Jerry Goldsmith score.
What?
I'm serious. They're like, yeah, well, an Oscar winner's good, but we'll go with an 80s synth band.
Like you do.
That's like trading a pile of gold for somebody shitting in your hand.
And the director's cut restores the Goldsmith score, which, you know, fits so much better with the movie. I'm still floored that this was a decision that somebody made. Like, for reals.
Someone got paid to make that decision.
Yeah,
someone got paid more money than all of us combined will see in our lives to make that decision.
I think, like, the underlying thing, though, is, like, with a lot of these recuts is that you just get a lot of different... It does sort of change the films around for you. And you don't really notice them until you see these different cuts. Or... you get a completely different film like Richard Donner, or you get five fucking cuts of Blade Runner that just confuses you because the story and the ideas keep changing from cut to cut to cut because no one can make up their goddamn mind. Like, yeah, he is a replicant. Yeah. No, he's not a replicant. Maybe he is a replicant. Well, he's just Harrison Ford. Look over there. What? You know, like, it gets, because I have all five cuts. I've watched them and I'm like, now I'm just confused. I don't know what to believe.
Maybe that's...
Maybe that's the whole point.
Yeah.
Well, now, if we're going to be talking about films that have been recut several times over, let us now point our guns at the original Star Wars trilogy, which has been recut for every single fucking home video release.
That's definitely like, you know, I have control, I can do what I want, I am doing this because it came to me in a dream scenario. And what drives me nuts is that one of the reasons studios, I think, have gotten a bit recut or at least re-release crazy is that we buy them. Like, almost blindly. Like, it's very like, God damn, I can't believe he's doing this. Yes, here's my credit card. God damn it, you know.
I will say, for my part, I sleep better at night knowing that while I did purchase some Star Wars box set on DVD, one side had that remastered hoopla with all of the terrible CG that they added to it, but the other side of the disc had the original home theater release, and I sleep better at night knowing that I have that.
Yeah, I have that one too.
I don't have that one. I've got three versions of the Star Wars trilogy. I've got the one last time release of the theatrical cut that they put out on VHS in the mid-90s.
I have that one.
I've got the special edition on DVD, which I hold as being sort of my favorite cut of the film. And then I've got the most recent one that they released, where they shooped in Hayden Christensen at the end of Return of the Jedi.
That made me so mad.
Stabbing. All of the stabbing in the world.
That pissed me off, and then I was also pissed off that they changed Boba Fett's voice to match Temuera Morrison's.
Yeah, they did do that. Yeah, I do remember that now, yeah.
More
yeah.
Stabbing. Stabbing all of the peoples.
Stabby, stabby, stabby.
Please know to stab.
And they made him a talkative son of a bitch in this cut. I was like, no! The whole point of Boba Fett is that he's mysterious. We don't know much about him, and he only speaks when necessary. And now he's just blah, talky, 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 talky. Shut the fuck up and shoot people!
Well, shoot and miss, because remember, he is cloned from Stormtroopers, so they tend to miss.
No, they're so, oh, but it's like, why do we need this? Why did we have to do this?
It's a money thing. Like, if no one bought it, I'm pretty sure they would stop. But people keep, you know, we sort of line up or we're sort of drugged like that. Another good example would be Wizard of Oz. When I started working at my day job in this sort of like media vendor thing, I remember coming across a big anniversary Wizard of Oz set. I think it was the first time it was on Blu-ray, and it was, you know, big, you had Blu-ray, you had DVDs, you had a booklet. You had a copy of the movie's budget, which I thought was sort of odd to add to it, but okay.
Whatever they got.
Yeah, and so it's all this kind of sort of, you know, different stuff. Then
I think sort of at this point, there have been so many releases of The Wizard of Oz that the only way that they could convince people to buy it new now would be if they actually included Dorothy's red slippers. And I don't think the Smithsonian is going to be willing to let go of those anytime soon.
Well, here's the thing. Last year, guess what? A new, brand new anniversary set got released. And you know what the big difference was, besides different booklet and they didn't have the budget anymore? It's in motherfucking 3D.
Why?
Because. Do we
need this? Because. And people bought it. Now, more people bought the Blu-ray single set, I've noticed, than the giant, you know, 80-some-odd-dollar 3D DVD combo. Here's a booklet. This is your contract signed in blood. We now own your soul set. But it's still there. And I'm pretty sure they've already got the next anniversary set planned.
Oh, doubtless.
Like, and because we sort of bought it. I mean, I bought the 35th anniversary, of Halloween this past Halloween, because I hadn't owned the movie, and really there was no big difference to it other than having a cool little booklet that talked about the film. But I'm pretty sure in 5 years there'll be a 40th anniversary that has a kind of a different booklet on it. And we sort of get trapped in, because every sort of, they're trying to keep up with the generation, you know, like as when these films first started coming out in VHS or DVD, I didn't have the money to buy them, but now I kind of do. And I kind of like the idea of getting sort of an anniversary set that's a little bit different, or maybe it's restored in some way or form. Because that one said it was, you know, they had restored the film, make it look nice. And they did that with actually also the OG RoboCop. Like, that one just got released, and that one was specifically made as being restored for a full-on Blu-ray release, so it looked good, because everything else before it was starting to degrade. So it's both money, and at the same time, it feels like they're trying to keep the films in good quality. You know, if you don't transfer it over, eventually it's just going to degrade, and you're going to lose it.
That's true. There's also another thing to mention, too. They're not only hitting people they've missed before with all these re-releases and re-releases, because like you said, there's always somebody who wanted it but couldn't afford it in the previous generation. Give them a couple years and now they can buy it. They also know that they're hitting the collectors, because they know there are some people out there who are going to buy every single edition of their favorite movie ever, as long as there's like one new thing included with it.
I'm that way with Star Wars, and I'm pretty sure Kat's that way with Jurassic Park.
Yes. Yes, I am.
New Jurassic Park is out. You must buy. Yes, master.
Do I need to spend $100 and get the one with the dinosaur figurine? Yes. Yes, I do.
Clever girl.
There you go. yeah, it's
now
it's,
there have been there have been cases where movies were released kind of incomplete, and then a later cut was actually found later of a more complete version of the movie. Didn't they recently discover the original cut of Fritz Lang's Metropolis a couple years ago?
God, I was so happy when I heard this. You have no idea.
Wait. They found the original cut?
Like, the original. They have restored all the lost footage.
The full movie? Oh my God, that's awesome.
Isn't it like 5 million hours long?
I had not heard this.
Something like that, yeah. it's a very long movie. I have not sat down to watch the full cut yet, but I have such a weird love for silent movies, so this excited me like nobody's business. And this will happen. This is more common with silent movies than it is other movies, because there aren't as many lost talkies as there are lost silence. In fact, I recently read a statistic. I may have mentioned this in one of my previous headlines, I'm not sure, but there was a study of silent films, and it was concluded that about 90% of the silent era of filmmaking is lost. Because they were destroyed, they just weren't preserved properly. There are even instances of some directors' old films like being like trashed and recycled. It's really, really terrible, because it's this whole era of filmmaking that just kind of vanished. And in a way, silent films are almost their own art form, completely different, their own genre, completely different from all other styles of filmmaking. But yeah, you do get that happening. Like I said, mostly with silent movies. Very, very occasionally, you'll get some bonus material resurfacing that was cut from a movie. That was cut from a movie before it went into theaters, and you'll get that as like an extra or an extended version. I'm having a very difficult time thinking of a specific example of this off the top of my head. I've read of a whole bunch of movies that had sequences, some of which actually, from what I've heard, made the movie make more sense. Because a lot of movies with issues tend to be the ones that got hacked up the worst by executive meddling. And I'm drawing a total blank, but I know this has happened many, many times. And stuff and things.
This is a question. There's the question I want to pose to Kat, because I know this has happened at least a couple of times to anime, where shows have been recut and redone, and in at least one case made into a completely different product from what it originally was. I think, didn't you tell me at one point that's what Robotech was?
Oh,
you are,
yeah.
Of course, referring to the massacre.
Oh, we need to talk about this, because this happened a lot in the early days of anime in the U.S., where they would, American companies would license a couple of shows for really cheap and splice it together and turn it into one thing. So the series that we know as Robotech, when it was originally released, is actually a hack and slash deal of three different series. I can't think of what they are off the top of my head, but
Macross,
Super Dimensional Fortress Macross,
Mospedia
is the third one. Yeah. But Southern Cross.
Southern Cross. Right. Right. So they.
Yay! Something I can talk about that I actually know.
Yes.
I'm so excited over here at the kiddie table right now.
Let's talk about cartoons now. Okay. Yay. Yeah.
I found that funnier than I probably should.
It's also worth noting that even when they didn't, you know, Frankenstein three series together. You know, actually, since it's three of them, maybe I should have said Human Centipede did three series.
Oh, you ruined it.
I facepalmed. I literally just facepalmed.
Boo.
I'll see myself to the pain club later. But even when they weren't like stitching three different series together, even when it was just one series, the amount of censorship and alterations and changes and abridging, like what they did to transform Go Lion into Voltron.
Oh my god. Let's talk about how different those characters are.
Yeah, seriously, right? Lothar's Oedipus Complex.
But we could honestly have a whole discussion about anime coming over to the U.S. and the bastardization thereof. But yeah, anime, they did that a lot in the day. They obviously don't do it anymore because there's the internet and people know better. And would
plus they have an older fan base now that they're aware of, and they know that that fan base will come after them with pitchforks and torches.
Yeah, and the Japanese companies have a little more power now to be able to direct how their products and how their shows and stuff are being treated. Speaking of like re-releases, I thought this was kind of interesting. Discotech Media, which is one of these really amazing little small anime companies, has been snatching up the licenses for older shows from like the 70s, 80s, and 90s. And they did a re-release of Samurai Pizza Cats.
Really?
Samurai Pizza Cats, yes. And then they did a proper release of the Japanese version of Samurai Pizza Cats, and they didn't put them together for some reason. They actually
released
them separately. But this is because Discotech is your friend and they love you and they want you to have nice things.
Oh, tell them I love them too. I send them flowers on Valentine's Day.
And they got a bunch of licenses, and somehow they got the English licenses for some of these titles, which I think is really weird because there's a couple of shows that were released not even a couple of years ago whatever English company, I think mostly it's ADV titles. ADV lost the license for it after ADV didn't become ADV anymore. And so they did lose some of their licenses, and Discotech swooped them up, but also somehow got the English dubs for them, and so they're actually re-releasing Dragon Half, which is going to be amazing. I'm so excited.
Oh, that's one of my favorites. I think it's a tragedy that they didn't adapt the rest of the manga.
Oh, it is. It is tragic, terribly tragic. But the thing I'm most excited about, and it's going to be the most spectacular re-release in the history of re-releases, they are going to re-release Ghost Stories, which...
Oh, is this the one that I'm thinking of?
It's the one you're thinking of, where this was a case where the show was so bad.
Oh, God.
The show was just so terrible.
With that dub track?
Yes. The Japanese company said, hey, dubbers, yes. Hey, dubbers, we don't care what you do with the English version as long as the story is kind of the same. And the English company said, are you sure? Because we're terrible people. And they said, whatever you want. So they dubbed this show to be the most offensive, off the wall, just in jokes and inappropriateness abound. Like, one of the characters is always talking about converting all of the Jews, and they make fun of the voice actors, and one of the characters is, like, clinically retarded and can't speak normally. And it was, of course, it released and it did terrible because nobody knew about this glorious dub that existed. And now Discotech is re-releasing the show, and of course it's going to have the Japanese version, but they also somehow got that terrible dub. And as soon as it's available, I'm going to buy it because I need this in my life.
Basically, what you're describing is kind of similar to the situation with Samurai Pizza Cats, only with like an R rating.
Yes.
See, also Duel Masters, which actually had a hilarious English dub.
Really?
Yeah, seriously, it's really weird. Like, the very first episode of the English dub of Duel Masters plays it straight. It's like, yes, this is a serious Yu-Gi-Oh! Ripoff, yada, yada, yada. But, like, every episode after the first episode was like, this show is shit and we know it. Like, they acknowledge that they're in a show. They acknowledge that it's a formula. They start going with like really bizarre gags. Like they start stretching that recurring gag of one character getting like knocked into the sky with a little team rocket. They start stretching that gag like way, way further, like animating extra sequences where he's like floating through space after that happens. And they actually got Richard Horvitz to voice a goblin for one episode.
But yeah, so when we bring it over, it's not always, you know, it's not always a big remaster. The biggest, probably the biggest offender of remasterings is probably Evangelion.
It's only, it's like, yeah. What, fourth version now?
God only knows, honestly, because they've recut and remastered it so many times. And every time, I've never understood why. And then they re-released it, redid the whole damn thing as films instead of as a series. And it's actually incredibly good.
Right. They're only on the third one thus far, right? They're still working on the fourth?
I think the fourth comes out this year. I'm not entirely sure because I haven't really like kept up with them too much, but they're quite good. And yeah. This was an instance in which, hey, this was animated 20 years ago, and now all of the animation techniques that the director dreamed of finally exist, and now he can do all of the things that he could never do before. So now he just wanted to go back and redo the whole thing to put the product as he envisioned it in his head. And I thought, well, I guess that's okay, because previously all of the re-releases seemed kind of like, okay, well, now you're just trying to milk that, you know, milk it for all it's worth. But like when you watch the new version with the Evangelion 1.0, whatever all those movies are, you really see the reasons why this was re-released, why the whole thing was redone. And it's almost the thing to do now, because there was Dragon Ball Z got reanimated, and it was Dragon Ball Z Kai, and Fullmetal Alchemist became, you know, they put out Fullmetal Alchemist Brotherhood to make it more accurate to the manga, and Hunter x Hunter just redid the whole damn thing for no reason at all. And
there's this other thing that's coming out in the near future that I hear a few people are excited about. Something about sailors and moons, perhaps?
I can't even begin to describe how amazing Sailor Moon is going to be. It's, yeah. The Sailor Moon was definitely done in honor of the 20th anniversary, I think. And that was one, it's a lot like Dragon Ball, where it strayed so far from the manga, and there was so much filler, and there's a lot of things where if you read the manga and you compare it to the anime, you can see where the director thought different things about the characters than Naoko Takeuchi thought. So, the new version is supposed to be way more accurate to the manga, and that's all we know. That's all we know.
And it also bearing in mind, I English good. it's also worth bearing in mind that since we were talking about, you know, all the censorship and the chopping and the massacre, I don't know how Carl Masek's name is pronounced, all that business that went on with early anime back in the day, that this release of Sailor Moon is not going to be changing characters' genders or sexual orientations around.
Yeah, and what's weird is that even some of the stuff that was in the anime in the Japanese version was different from the manga. And then what ended up coming over to America was different from the Japanese. Because each... You know, what can go on? I don't understand most of the decisions that they made for the TV series. I think the director fucked a lot of it up because I rewatch it and I go, this doesn't make sense. Why are these characters gay now? That doesn't make sense. And of course, I'm talking about the Shiteno, the Barrel's Four Generals, like, and two of them are gay for some reason in the anime, and it just doesn't make sense. And so of course then they were brought over and one of them was a woman in the dub. And so we should definitely be seeing, and we should be seeing less censorship, but that also has a lot to do with a lot of the fans are grown up now, and we can things on television that we couldn't have in the 90s in terms of anime. So we still can't put fucking blood on television, but surely we'll be able to have lesbians. Surely.
Adult Fingers Swim crossed. Adult Swim is already champing at the bit.
Everybody should be champing at the bit. This is going to be a huge release this year. Really, really excited, because now all of the fans who grew up watching it are all older and are going to be able to. Like, I couldn't afford to buy all of that show. It's kind of like what we talked about a little bit before, but I couldn't afford to buy all that show when it was first being released, because $30 a videotape for three all episodes.
For three, three fucking episodes.
Too much show for the cat.
And now there's going to be, it's going to release simultaneously worldwide online, and then hopefully we'll see a Blu-ray and DVD release.
Oh, we will.
We will, but I haven't heard if anybody's got the license for it or not.
They're just
Do we know when it's going to be released?
It's going to be released this summer. It's been delayed so many times, it makes me cry.
Well, maybe we'll have to do a show on it.
You might?
She's going to tie us down? You will watch this.
I will go get
my
fucking crescent moon wand. Where is it?
It's Oh man. Okay. So okay. All right. Let's see. What time
are we
is
talking about again?
About 20 to 8. You guys think we've got enough show here?
Oh, we got plenty of show.
We've got so much show.
We have show ideas for new shows.
Like Sailor Moon.
All right. Well, that's about all. All right. Then I guess we'll just end it. We'll cut it off here. That's about all the time we have for Nerd of the Third Power this week. Thank you as always for tuning in. We'll see you guys next week. As always, I'm Dr. Gonzo.
I'm the cat.
I'm Brian.
I'm John, and I approved of this message.
And I'm the Blast Seeker.
All right. We'll see you next
week. Don't forget,
we'll see you next week. Taka, play us out.
Should have said I'm Sailor Cat. That would have been awesome.
Aw, you can do